Yes, we are going to start the address, the very first chapter in your snapshots. This address is basically a story about how war, brings death, destruction, and depression. Death and destruction, everybody knows. But it also brings a depression in the later state. How it affects the common people's life. It is about that. It's not only that during, before the war and during the war, humanity suffers. It's not only this much. People keep suffering even when the war is over, and even later years, you know, the effects remain prominent. The dropping of bombs at the Hiroshima and Nagasaki during Second World War. That is still, you know, that is still something which is very, very fresh. People have not forgotten like the consequences of those anecdotes of war. And war, especially the world wars, which have their effects and fangs throughout the world. Here in the story, we are going to talk about one family, especially one girl, the one from whom we will come to know, like how many people, how many countless people suffer even after the war. So this chapter is about like how the Nazis, the Hitler's party, that is the Nazis, you know, how they tried to suppress the Jews in Holland. Countless people were rendered homeless. They went in for the concentration camps and died there. Diary of Anne Frank. You people might have read that also. So that is, that case was also one of those Nazis who underwent, sorry, the Jews who underwent these kinds of oppressions. So it was during the concentration camp only where Anne Frank had died. Okay, she was hardly 14 years of age when she died in the concentration camp. So the complete description of the way they lived life in the concentration camps, the haunting life that is there in that diary of Anne Frank. And even you'll get the glimpse of that kinds of life here also. Not exactly during the concentration camp, but afterwards. So the protagonist of the story is, in the story, the protagonist is the, one is Mrs. S. We will not meet her. She will be there when she is no more. The protagonist of the story is the daughter of Mrs. S. Got it? And there is one more woman, Mrs. Dorling. D-O-R-L-I-N-G. Okay? Spelling D-O-R. Mrs. Dorling. So what had happened is, during the Second World War, in Holland, when the Jews were living a very unpredictable life because of the war, the Jews were like, they were thinking, they had the fear like they might have to go for the concentration camps. They would be thrown by the Nazis. Because of this fear, the Nazis, they started, you know, started making plans to safeguard their house or the household objects. Mrs. S, she is a very refined, polished, and a gentle woman. She had a lot of, you know, crockery. You can say all household things. She had infused life into whatever she had. She used to take a lot more care of her every object of the house. Okay? You people might have seen that some women are very particular about their household objects. Okay, for them a little dent on one, spoon, they cannot tolerate. For them each and every object, they take very minutely care of it. So Mrs. S was that. One day, when Mrs. S's daughter came home, she might have come home from hostel or from some trip, we don't know. It's not mentioned. So when she came home, she found that certain things in the house were missing. Got it? And she asked her mother, something is missing, and mother was very happy that thank God you realized that something is missing. Because usually what happens in the homes, that mothers only know everything. Children especially, they never ever bother what thing is where. Right? So mother was happy to see that her daughter knew that something was missing. And then the daughter also saw that there was a lady who had a broad back. She saw a broad-backed woman who was about to leave their house with a big bag with her. The girl asked her mother, this girl asked Mrs. S, that who that woman is and what is she taking with her? Then Mrs. S told her that this is Mrs. Darling, who is helping them. How was Mrs. Darling helping them? By taking their household objects with her. Mrs. S was giving the household objects to Mrs. Darling. Why? Because it was war time. The Nazis might have to go and leave the house. And maybe in case of emergency, they will have to leave. Then what will happen to their house and household objects? So she had asked Mrs. Darling, I'm repeating, Mrs. S had asked Mrs. Darling to take all the valuables from the home so that they remain safe with her. Clear? Clear? What was Mrs. Darling carrying with her? The household objects of Mrs. S. Why? For safety. Why was there a question of safety, Pulkit? Why were the things unsafe? Wrong. Listen carefully. It was a war time. During war, in case Mrs. S had to leave, then what will happen to the household objects? So she had given all the things of the house, not all, some valuables to Mrs. Darling. Her idea was that when the war will be over, we will take the things from you back. Got it? So Mrs. Darling was taking everything, not everything, the valuables from their house. The daughter asked her mother, why, mom? Daughter did not like that broad-backed woman. Who this broad-backed woman was? Mrs. Darling. She didn't like her. She was quite apprehensive about the woman, but mother made her, dispelled all her doubts and told her not to suspect that woman because she was helping them. She was helping them by taking away the things from their house so that they remain safe. Up till here, what was Mrs. Darling doing for her help? She had become a custodian. She was trying to retain the hope, faith, and trust of her friend. And now we expect that when the war will be over, she will return everything to these people. And it should be, because it's a matter of trust. It's a matter of mutual understanding. It's a matter of humanity also. When one person betrays somebody, then the whole humanity comes under the line of question mark. The whole humanity gets questioned. One person does something wrong, other 100 people become warned. Aise hi hota na? We people have always heard of the things like somebody knocked at the door of somebody and that person happens to be a thief. And now what happens? We are very, very alert while opening the door. Got it? Okay. So, then Mrs. S told her, like, this is Mrs. Darling who lives at 46. 46. Marconi Street. They were living in the same town where these people were living. Okay. So she told her, like, this Mrs. Darling lives at 46 Marconi Street. She told this address very casually to her daughter. But the irony was that what she told her very casually became a very, very solemn occasion, or you can say solemn remembrance for the daughter. The war was over, but Mrs. S, along with her whole family, died in the war. Only daughter survived the war. She was not there at the time at home. So we are guessing that she might have gone for a, she might be in the hostel. Okay, because she would come and go. So that's why the daughter survived the war. Okay. After the war was over, she had lost her family. This girl started living in a small rented room. She lost her family. She lost her house. Right? She started living in a small rented room. Then after many years, she started remembering her mother and her things. Then she thought of going to Mrs. Darling and reclaiming her objects. She had to travel a long distance. She did a long journey and she reached the right address. She knocked at the door. And when you reach some place for the first time, then unless and until the person says that, yes, you are at the right place, you are not sure, right? So she knocked at the door. She rang the bell, rather. The woman came. She opened the room, she opened the door a little bit and she looked out of that, crank. She didn't open the door thoroughly. She opened a little bit and from there she peeped out. She said, yes. The girl said, like, is this 46 Marconi Street? She pointed out, like, I want to see Mrs. Darling. Are you Mrs. Darling? The woman did not acknowledge her. She pretended that she did not know her. The girl was actually making advances to come inside. But that woman, she rebuffed her advances and told her that she did not have the time to talk about past. Because she had something very important to do. With this, she closed the door and went inside. And during this much of short talk, the girl had seen that Mrs. Darling, that is that woman, was wearing a green cardigan. And it was her mother's cardigan. One always remembers one's mother's clothes. So that girl knew that she was wearing her mother's cardigan, and she was sure that she was at the right address. Then, because the woman had refused to talk to her, so this girl had no option but to go back to her house. She came back. While she was moving back, she looked around at the whole city, the same town, but it had changed drastically over the years. Second time she came, she had made up her mind that I will go and take my things. Second time when she came, then this time the door was opened by Mrs. Darling's daughter. Okay? She was hardly 15 or 16 years of age, and she welcomed her rather. Mrs. Darling's daughter took her inside, and all the moment this girl, which girl? Mrs. S's daughter. Now, the moment she entered the house, at the very porch, she saw, at the very entrance, she saw the candle stand of her mother. It was lying there. But before that, she started feeling a little suffocated because of the damp smell of the house. Each house has a significant smell. Agree or not? Each house is different because of smell also. So she did not like the damp smell of the house. Anyways, she went inside. In the very drawing room, she saw the dining, at the very dining table, the dining table cloth was of her mother's. But that dining table cloth had become worn out over the years. I told you in the very beginning that mother, Mrs. S, she used to put life into her things. But here the things were not at all taken care of. That cloth had become worn out, black. But the girl was able to identify that it was the same dining cloth because of a burnt mark on it. Otherwise, maybe she would not have identified that. And I told you about the candle stand. The girl says that the candle stand which was lying there, her mother used to take it out on very, very rare occasions. But here it was like that only, and it had become full of dust. So the things which were so dear to mother, they were lying casually here. Then the girl offered her something, and the cutlery, the spoons, they were of her mother. Everything in the house was of Mrs. S. But very soon the girl started feeling suffocating in that house, and she did not like being there for more than 10 minutes. And immediately she stood up and said, okay, bye. And she made up her mind not to reclaim anything and never to return back to this place. She went empty-handed. Now the question arises. The story ends here. Why didn't she claim anything? Why didn't the girl claim anything? She could have asked the girl, this is mine and I'm going to take it. Why didn't she claim anything? Yes, you are very right. Very good answer. Very good. Well done. When something is with us, or when something is with our near and dear ones, we value the things because of their attachment with those people. But when the same things are in the hands of somebody else, they lose that connectivity, they lose that touch. So those things have no value then. If your mother is very fond of one particular dress, you also like that dress because you know that your mother likes it. But if the same kind of dress is with somebody else also, then that dress will be of no use for you. Because one particular thing which is dear to your mother is important for you because of the connection with your mother. And the same thing will have no value if it is with somebody else. So now those very things, materialistic things, they had lost that attachment. They had lost that value for this girl, which they had when they were with the mother. So she did not want to reclaim them. So this chapter is about, of course, about the futility of war. What does war bring in the end? Depression. Who is happy with war? No one. Even the victorious parties are not happy, because victory is never gained without sacrifice. So sacrifice is always there, and that sacrifice is of the human lives. And human life is something which is most important. If you get one territory or one area because of the war, no one will remember that. No one will love that as it is. Okay, one particular party or one particular ruler might do these kinds of things for his own whim. But actually, no one likes these things. No one values them. Human life is most important, which should be valued. Right? So, yes, this story has been set up during the post-war conditions. So even after many years, war does not erase its negative side. It still remains there. Right? So that is about the overall chapter. So we might start reading the chapter tomorrow, and you also read it. So I'll see tomorrow if you people all read the chapter on your own. We can discuss its question answers. Okay, read the chapter thoroughly. Would that be fine, children? Yes, somebody can send me these screenshots. Okay. So Samriddhi, send me the screenshot of attendance. Okay, see you tomorrow.